Feet of Bhagavan, dear brothers and sisters, we will be completing the August syllabus, I should say, from the examination point of view of students, our quota or the course of conversations we have had during that month, August, and we will be completing that positively this evening. Well, I am also glad to know that there is very good response to these conversations, for which I don't take any personal credit. I am very well aware of it. As people have no access to these conversations, they are interested to hear what is transacted there in the veranda. So they are interested to know, as they have no access, that's all. So with no personal credit or glorification, I am least given to them. I am glad that there is very good response from all our Sai devotees. That evening, Swami started speaking on certain spiritual aspects, deep philosophical aspects. Each sentence is very important for every one of us. The first statement he made was, consider this body as an instrument. This statement is significant for more than one reason. We consider this body as ourselves. Rather, I identify myself with this body, which is not true, because the body goes on changing from time to time, or even drop any moment without any formal announcement. So how can I consider myself that I am the body? Then what value is to be given to this body? What value is to be given to this body? The answer is simple. The body is an instrument, that's all. The body is to be used as an instrument for the realization of the purpose for which it is meant. Body is given, body is obtained because of that process of birth. We are born not to be born again. We are born not to be born again. It is towards this end this body has to be used as a powerful instrument in the divine mission. Second statement Baba made was this: know that God is the master of this body. God is the owner of this body. Let me just explain this, because some explanation is needed. Some elaboration will help us to know the seriousness or the gravity or depth or profundity of the statement. It is from that background I am explaining. Do I consider that God is the master of my body? I may say so, but without any experience. If I consider God is the master of this body, all my actions will necessarily be godly. All my thoughts will be divine. All my actions will be sacred. All my words are bound to be full of truth. But in reality it is not so. The words are full of lies. Actions are selfish. Thoughts are self-centered, and still I declare that God is the master of this body. It is utterly ridiculous. So not only by word but in spirit we have to accept that God is the master of this body, which will be reflected by our words, thoughts and actions. And third statement, reduce or cut short your body attachment. What does it mean? Because we are attached to this body, we suffer more than what we should. When once there is awareness that I am not the body, the intensity of suffering or the gravity of suffering will be less. Not that there will be no suffering, there will be pain, but it will not be more painful than what it should have been. So our attitude will change. Our attitude towards life will change when we are less attached to our body, when we are less identified to our body. That's what Bhagavan said. And then, why are we attached to this body? What does it lead to? Where does it lead to? The answer, Bhagavan said, was our illusion. Our illusion is responsible for this body attachment, leading to grief or misery or sadness. There is no benefit after all. There is no advantage after all with this body identification, excepting suffering, misery, that's all. The cause for this body attachment happens to be illusion or delusion. That's what Bhagavan wants us. Not to be mistaken, not to get ourselves identified with this body. And now, Swami, what is illusion then? What is illusion then? The famous oft-repeated quote, the famous illustration of Upanishads, Bhagavan mentioned that evening. What is it? There lies a rope, but you mistake it to be a snake. In fact, it is not a snake, it is only a rope. It is only your mistaken identity. It is only your wrong identification that made you confused and totally fear-stricken. You run away from there, thinking it is snake, but actually it is not snake. It is only rope over there. So mistaken identification or mistaken identity is what is called illusion. The reality is not understood. We go by falsification. We go by superimposition. That is responsible for illusion leading to fear. That's what Bhagavan said. Now he gave one example. It seems an young man was crying. A noble soul of awareness happened to pass by the street. And he asked, "Young man, why are you crying, my boy? What makes you cry?" This young man said, "I lost my mother. My mother who loved me so much is no more. I lost my mother, therefore I am crying." And this wise man said, "Where has she gone? Your mother is here lying. Your mother is very much here. You have not lost her. She is here. Why do you cry?" It only means the body is there, but not the life. If you consider the life is the body, mother is not lost. Mother is there. But still the boy is crying because the body of the mother is there, but not the mother in reality. Why? Life is gone. So this mistaken identification with the body, the wrong identification of the body, is what is called illusion or delusion, leading to fear and the subsequent sadness. That's what Bhagavan has said. So now Bhagavan gives one example. To think that I am Indian, to think that I am Russian, to think I am American is also an illusion. Also an illusion. because you are born in American, in America, so you are an American, but you are not America. You are born in America, you are American by citizenship, and you are not America. You are different. No, you are here in India. So, you are not the place where you belong to, you are not the profession that you do, you are not the gender that you refer to, you are beyond. The reality is none of these. The true self is above all of them. Bhagavan comes forward with a beautiful example. The whole world is like a beautiful mansion, like a beautiful building. Each room is a country. Each room is a country. To consider this room is the only building is my foolishness. This building has so many rooms of this nature, so many rooms of this type. All rooms together make one building. Similarly, the whole world is one mansion. And rooms are different countries. And what is it that separates us? What is it that differentiates us? What is it that demarcates us? Only the walls of caste, community, race, nationality, caste, creed, cadre, that's all. When once all these walls are removed, when once all these narrow chains are cut off, we are all one. The caste of humanity, the religion of love. The realization of oneness is the truth. And the experience of diversity, the life of diversity, multiplicity, plurality is illusion. That's what Bhagavan has said that evening. Finally, he concluded telling, boys, develop that broad-mindedness. Expansion is life. Contraction is death. Contraction is death. Have broad-mindedness, vastness of the spirit. Understand that. There you find bliss, but not in contraction or in narrow-mindedness. Now I move on to the next episode. This gives an example from the life of Bhagavan. Bhagavan that day said this. He sat there on the chair and suddenly he called one gentleman from the devotees. Elderly person wearing a dhoti with a long shirt, lalchi as you know, and a dhoti, quite a pretty old man. He called him, come here. He came. Then he has introduced him to all of us. He said that this man is a correspondent of chain of schools in the state of Karnataka. And then he looked at him seriously and said, what is it that you are doing there in those schools? You have named your schools after me. All your schools, you name them as Sri Satyasai schools. But you are collecting money. You are collecting fees. You are collecting money for examination, sports, library and all that. That is very bad. You cannot bear my name in the name of money. Money and Sai Baba will never go together. You cannot have my name if you want to collect money like that. Any fundraising I am dead against. You understand? That gentleman started shivering. Swami, beg your pardon, I don't. Immediately after your return, refund all the money. Refund. And write to me. Then only I will permit you to enter into Prashantralayam. But not otherwise. And Baba said, it is not proper on your part to keep education for sale like that. Just as you sell out toothpaste and matchbox. You cannot keep education for sale. I don't like it. Don't do that. That Bhagavan has said. And further Swami also made a comment. Some people just offer old, used clothes to many people. And they say, we are doing service. What are you doing? Distributing old clothes. It is not charity. It is not charity. It is not sacrifice. You are clearing out the junk. That's all. So if you want to give clothes, you should give brand new clothes. If you want to call it donation or sacrifice or seva, not worn out, torn out, old, used clothes and call it charity. It is all drama. It is all stunt. I don't want you to do that. That's what Bhagavan said. In this context, I should tell you, in the state of Karnataka, each medical seat costs 25 lakhs of donation apart from regular fees. Apart from regular boarding, lodging, college fees, they have to pay in advance 25 lakhs of donation. Then only they get a medical seat. Swami laughed and said, instead of studying medicine, if you keep those 25 lakhs in the bank, plus 5 lakhs college fees, tuition fees, sports fee, game fee, exam fee, library fee, plus your food, accommodation, 10 more lakhs. 35 lakhs if you keep in the bank, you'll get 35,000 rupees as interest. You can sit cross-legged without studying. You can be a Maharaja, a king. Why college? Why studies? So education has become today a sort of mockery. Why for lower KG, kindergarten? There in Bangalore, one has to pay 25,000 rupees donation. 3-year-old child to get into LKG, lower kindergarten, 25,000 rupees donation is required. So, education has become so commercial. So, Bhagavan is dead against that and he doesn't like it. And Swami said finally, if you want to start institutions in my name, take me as an ideal. Take me as an ideal. And know that whatever I say is truth. You can verify wherever you go. And my path is very clear, righteous. My words are nothing but truth. And I am the ideal to all of you. That's what Bhagavan said that evening. Now we pass on to next episode of the month of August 2002. Swami, most unusually that evening, sat on the chair after interviews, sat in a relaxed mood, nicely looking at me and said, put some question. We don't know what to ask, what not to ask, what the mood is, what type of questions he expects. Swami, yes, ask some questions. Then I thought, convenient thing is to put a question on Ramayana so that it is less risky. Less risky. If I put some questions on deep philosophy, he may say, so many students are there, you selfish fellow. Ask those questions which will be useful to students. Don't ask them. Suppose I say, Swami, grant me an interview tomorrow. Who says, it's not... It's not a question. You are a selfish fellow. Fish is better than selfish. So I'll get back the voice. Then I thought, convenient safe thing is to put a question on Ramayana. Then I said, Swami, there are so many epics in Hindu Vedanta. The story of Krishna is Bhagavatam. The story of Rama is Ramayana. the story of Pandavas and Kauravas and the battle of Kurukshetra is Bharatam. These three are important epics, apart from so many epics. There are so many. Mythology. So many. These three are prominent. I have one question. Oh, what is it? Ask, ask. We have so many versions of Ramayana. A great saint by Tulasidas, wrote his own version of Ramayana called Ramacharita Manas. Ramacharita Manas, written by Tulasidas. Valmiki composed original Ramayana. One lady by name Molla, M-O-L-L-A, she wrote another Ramayana, Molla Ramayana. There is another gentleman by name Kamban, K-A-M-B-A-N. He wrote another Ramayana, Kamba Ramayana. Sage Vyasa wrote another Ramayana, called Adhyatma Ramayana, spiritual Ramayana. What is all this? Which one is true? Why so many? Why? Why not in other cases? Why not so many Mahabharatams? Why not so many Mahabhagavatams? Why only so many Ramayana? Why? Is it not confusing? Of all the one, which one is correct? Which one should I follow? Which one is authentic? Then Bhagavan laughed and said, was so compassionate. He said, there are so many versions on Ramayana. The reason is, Ramayana has a message to convey. At the individual level, social conduct, ethical nature, as a householder, as a brother, as a ruler, as a husband, as a friend, as an ideal man, how one should behave. All these aspects are very well dealt in Ramayana. The social, ethical, moral, individual, political, all roles put together, rolled into one, has been dealt in detail in that holy epic Ramayana. So each one started focusing one aspect. So you have so many Ramayana. Some have dealt in depth the devotional aspect. Some have dealt in higher intensity the social aspect, the individual aspect. Therefore, their perspective, multi-dimensional aspect of Ramayana has been dealt by many people on different occasions and in different periods of time. And therefore you have so many versions of Ramayana. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then I could understand that it is time that I can take little lenience. There is, because mood seems to be good, take some little risk. And then I said, Swami, if Krishna is God, how can he afford to be partial to Pandavas? Can God be partial? Kauravas also are his children. He should be impartial. The whole Bharata speaks of total partiality of Krishna. How can he be God? I am not able to reconcile. Knowing full well that you are going to support Krishna because you were same Krishna in the previous incarnation. I know that you support it. But still, I am not able to take it. Please explain. Bhagavan said, all your misnomers, all your misconceptions, all your misapprehensions are the signs of your total, utter, complete ignorance. Your ignorance is responsible for this confusion, for this sorry state of affairs. Secondly, you have no total faith in Krishna as God. If you have total faith in God, you will never question His actions. If you say He is partial, and questioning that, can He be partial being God? It means you have no faith in Krishna as God. So, absence of faith, lack of devotion, and ignorance are responsible for such a lopsided view or wrong impression. Oh, I see. Now it is coming back to me. Then, okay, Swami, but how do you justify that? How do you justify Krishna being partial to Pandavas? That is my question. I am ignorant. I lack faith. I am sufficiently foolish. I do accept. But what is your answer to my question? That Krishna is partial to Pandavas. Can he do like that? Then Swami said, all right, I'll give you straight answer. Pandavas followed Krishna completely. Pandavas followed Krishna's command totally, fully, unconditionally. Because they followed Krishna totally, He supported them. They were devoted to Him completely. It's not partial or conditional or part-time devotion. It's a total devotion in times of pleasure and pain. In moments of challenging situations and also in war, in times of humiliation, they followed Krishna totally. So Krishna supported them. How can you say he is partial? Oh Swami, my case is lost. Now I understand. God cannot be partial. He may look partial because of my ignorance. So if God is to support us, if God is to stand by us, we have got to follow His command totally. We must develop trust in Him unconditionally. Swami said, had you known this earlier, you would not have put this question. Then I said, Swami, you yourself said, I am a man of ignorance, so naturally I put this question. My question is justifiable. But your answer made me free from that ignorance. I am no longer ignorant of the facts. Everybody laughed, joined in laughter. With that evening session concluded. Now I go on to the next episode of the month of August 2002. Bhagavan somehow started with some serious remarks. Again, in philosophical lines. In spiritual line of thought. But if we listen to others, we don't doubt, we don't have any doubts by listening to others, because we don't listen to them totally. But we hear Swami in rapt attention, therefore we get doubts. I think you agree with me. We don't hear everybody with total attention. Because God is speaking to me, I am in total awareness and I am trying to take every word, and hence some doubt arises. Is it possible? Can I practice? What is it I am thinking about this so long? Naturally, there is wide scope for doubts. Somehow, even if we put some questions to other gurus, they may give some evasive replies. As a typical escapist. And their answers are not satisfactory to us. But courtesy wants us, demands us to say, thank you, very nice answer. It is not nice. But in the case of Swami, it is totally different. His answer is straight, simple. It will drive home straight. There's no question of any doubt or ambiguity, anything whatsoever. That evening Swami mentioned that statement. Ekam eva dvitiyam brahma. Ekam, E-K-A, E-K-A-M, ekam. Eva, E-V-A. Dvitiyam, D-W-I. THY THIYAM, dvitiyam, THIYAM, brahma, ekameva dvitiyam brahma. Because when you transcribe, I don't want to leave very bit of doubt, therefore I am giving spelling also. Swami mentioned this statement, ekameva dvitiyam brahma. This is a very wonderful statement, which everybody should know, should learn, should repeat and get it by heart. It is worth knowing what is the meaning of that. Ekam, E-K-A-M, one. Eva, E-V-A, only one. One, Eva, only one. Dvitiyam Brahma, Brahma, God, Dvitiyam, not two. God is one, only one, and not two. Swami wondered out, what? When you say God is only one, is it not enough? Why should you say not two? I know that I am very poor in mathematics, agreed. But if you say only one, that is enough, I can understand. Why not two? Eva, only one, good. Dvitiyam Brahma, not two. Why should you say that? Why? Then Swami said, look here, for emphasis it is said. For emphasis, to give additional stress, to give no chance for any misunderstanding, for any digression, for any perversion, for any misrepresentation or misinterpretation, God said clearly, Ekam eva dvitiyam brahma. God is only one and not two. Okay, Swami, there is another statement. Please explain. Prajnanam, P-R-A-J-N-A-N-A-M. Prajnanam Brahma. This is also Mahavakya. It is not difficult. I want all of you to remember this statement, reflect upon this statement, a beautiful statement. All statements are beautiful, but those are simple. We can remember them well. I am not a scholar in Sanskrit. Only these statements that are repeated by Bhagavan, I certainly remember them and quote in my talks. It may look as if I am a scholar in Sanskrit. I am telling you, I am not. And I don't want to be. Because God knows all languages. I need not learn Sanskrit to make God understand my language. God knows all languages. I don't need to learn complicated language at this age and complicate my life. No. I can manage with my language. I can manage with my ideas and make God understand and get replies what I want. So, but certain statements, very simple, easy to remember. Prajnanam Brahma. Swami, please explain this. Mahavakya. Mahavakya. M-A-H-A. V-A-K-Y-A. Mahavakya. A great statement. A very profound statement. Prajnanam Brahma. What is it, Swami? He said, how do you understand? He wants me to say and expose before everybody. How little I know. Very good, I take delight in it. Why not? If I am an object of entertainment for God and my students, what more I want? Instead of making everybody laugh at my class, very good. I want every evening to be like that. Yes. I am not a kill joy to anybody. I am source of entertainment to God. God laughs and boys laugh. Why not? Yes, laughter is religion. Seriousness is sickness. Yes. Bliss is God. Misery is the world. So why can't we laugh? Then Bhagavan said, tell me how you understand about Prajnanam Brahma. I said, Swami, knowledge is God. Prajnanam, knowledge. Brahman, God. Knowledge is God. Swami said, in his usual way, you are completely wrong. Very good. I am not shocked because I was always wrong. But I congratulate myself because my wrong answers provoked him to speak along these lines. Yes. So I wish to give wrong answers always. Why not? All right, let him say what he wants to. Bhagavan now explained. There are few forms of knowledge. One is prajnana, P-R-A-J-N-A, prajnana. Second, sujnana, S-U-J-N-A. Third, vijnana, V-I-J-N-A. Prajnana, sujnana, vijnana. Fourth, jnana, J-N-A-N-A, four. Oh, I see. I don't know, there are four types of knowledge. Swami started explaining. First, jnana. J-N-A-N-A, jnana. What is jnana? All the information, all the knowledge, all the worldly information is jnana. Everyone has this. Material knowledge, secular knowledge, education, humanity, science, technology, that is all jnana. I see. Second, vijnana. Vijnana is the knowledge based on investigation, cause and effect, experimentation, observation and inference. So vijnana is science and technology. Jnana, vijnana. Third one, sujnana. Sujnana, S-U-J-N-A, sujnana. What is sujnana? Sujnana is spiritual knowledge. Oh, I see. The fourth one, prajnana, P-R-A-J-N-A. Prajna. What is prajnana? Prajnana is your very being. Prajnana is your very self. Prajnana is awareness. Prajnana is constant integrated awareness. The supreme self, the knowledge of the self, the awareness of the self, the very core of your life, the very being of your life is what is called prajnana. That prajnanam brahma, that prajnana is divine. That's the reason why Vedanta says, you are sons of, or rather, you are the children of immortality. You are the children of eternity. You are the embodiments of divine Atma. Why? At the core, I am divine. In the periphery, I am human. Just like orange fruit covered by the rind or the skin, inside there is sweet juice. Similarly, peripheral, name and form, separate me from my true reality of the self. That true reality of the self is prajnana, awareness. Prajnam Brahma. When once I close my eyes, turn inward and think of my very being and put a question to myself, who am I? Go on answering that I am not the body, I am not the intellect, I am not the mind, I am not the five senses or action, I am not the five life sheets, I am not the five elements. I am the eternal Atma, the Supreme Spirit. This is what is called theory of negation or neti, N-E-T-H-I. By negating that what you are not, you arrive at that what you really are. What you really are, you arrive at that. And that is the Supreme Self, that consciousness, that awareness, that experience of the true Self is what is called prajnana. That prajnana, the individual Self, when once you experience, it expands. It turns cosmic, that the whole cosmos, that the whole universe is divine. Every entity in this world, every object in this world, be that microcosm or macrocosm, will appear divine from the point of the Self. Through the lens, through the spectrum of prajnana, the awareness of the Self, the knowledge of the Self, will have the cosmic vision. We'll have cosmic vision. That's what Bhagavan said that afternoon. We come to the close of the August 2002 with this last episode. It so happened that evening. Suddenly, afternoon to be more correct, suddenly I received a message that I am to report there in the mandir immediately. I didn't have enough of time to have my hot coffee. I am used to very, very hot coffee. No compromise in its temperature. Very hot. So, I didn't have time. So, I simply ran because I cannot run the risk, because I know the punishment that would follow. So I ran and sat. I saw many people inside the mandir who already assembled by that time. I came to know later they are all doctors from Bombay. About 500 of them. Yes. 200 ladies, 300 gents, all of them are doctors. They came to visit Prashant Narayan and see Bhagavan. And they already visited the super speciality hospital there in Bangalore on the previous day. And that day morning, they visited super speciality here in Prashant Narayan, and they are all waiting for an interview. Bhagavan gave them mass interview, not individual. They all assembled. Therefore, I was benefited to translate his talk. In so doing, I can also enjoy. Translation, though it is a difficult job, though it is a challenging job, yet it is worth it. Because I am also a student of Sai literature. I am very much interested in Sai message. So, doesn't matter whatever people feel about me. I want to take any number of opportunities like that. No matter I commit mistakes. No matter I stand corrected quite often. Much to the amusement of all of you. Doesn't matter. Sometimes I also forget to translate. I say, Abba, what a statement, Swami. Swami said, what happened to you? You are here to translate whatever I say. What is this ecstasy? Come back to your senses. Then I tell him, Swami, I am not a mechanical loudspeaker. I am not an electronic gadget. I am also a devotee. I love your message. I am sorry. And then I translate. So, that's how I take it. That day, Swami started speaking to them. Suddenly he turned to one doctor who is aged 70. He told him, you underwent heart surgery, right? The doctor, yes, Swami. Oh. Alright, this morning you visited super specialty hospital and had another checkup, right? Yes, Swami. Then he said, I know. You are a doctor and also a patient. Doesn't matter, I know. Very good. And all doctors said, you are fine now, right? Yes, Swami. Then he said, I may be here, but I know what all that's happening everywhere. I know. This doctor said, Swami, I have peacemaker inside. With this peacemaker, I am able to manage. It is artificial, Swami. Swami said, everyone is artificial in this world. Not only you. The whole life is artificial today. Don't worry, not only your peacemaker. Everyone is artificial. The whole life is artificial. Don't worry. And then he said, where is the heart? Where is the heart? Swami, it is inside. Oh, heart is inside, but art is outside. But when the art comes from the heart, it will be interesting. But today, even art is also artificial. That art is not coming from the heart. So, life is artificial. That's what Swami said. Oh, there are peals of laughter. Cheers. Oh, everybody started laughing. Then Swami said, oh, doctors, look at me. I am 77. I don't have glasses. I can see any remote object. Yes. And I have no pain, no suffering anytime. I don't take any pills or tonics, nothing. Nothing doing. After all, I eat only small lump of ragi malt. That's all. Ragi malt. I don't take coffee or tea or breakfast, idli, vada, dosa like you fellows. I don't take. Only ragi malt. And only next day I have the same thing. Nothing in between. I am quite strong, energetic. You have to understand. How about my weight? For the last 55 years, 108 pounds. It has not changed. Check up my BP. Perfect normal blood pressure. How is it possible? You may be wondering, how is it possible? First thing, I have total control on my diet, food. I don't eat all stuff like kurma, barma as you eat. Kurma, K-U-R-M-A. A preparation, spicy stuff. Swami made a pun of this word kurma. Burma is the name of the country, as you know. Kurma, Burma, pun of the word. So I don't eat all that spicy stuff. No. Believe me or not, that's what Swami said. Believe me or not, I don't know what appetite is. I don't know what hunger is. I don't know. I am never hungry. No. But, since there are some guests, to give some company, I pretend as if I am eating. They sit there. That's all. My friends, please believe me. I was there at the dining table with Swami thousands of times. I am not speaking with any pride, in all humility and respect to brothers and sisters here, with absolute affirmation that you have known me sufficiently by now, that I am not a man of show and publicity. In all humility I am telling you, if we start eating like Baba, we will be no more tomorrow. Finish. Inform our people, everybody, and start eating like him. I don't know. Wonder of wonders. He just mixed some rice and some rasam like this. Hari Om Tat Sat. He will get up and go. I don't know what that eating is, I don't know. But there, that the gentleman who goes on serving, Swami, this, I'll ask you to get out, I don't want. He will never say, put it. We will never say, I don't want. Just the opposite direction we turn. I don't want. We'll say, welcome, my dear. We are so courteous. We welcome all dishes because food is God. We should welcome God, you know. We should not. But actual God says no to the food. So it's really very interesting. And one doctor asked, Swami, would you please explain to us about Gayatri? My friends, all these statements are recorded here. Nothing is fabricated. Nothing is left to the stretch of my imagination. All these statements are written here. And for information, all these things appeared in Telugu version of Sanatana Sarathi. For the last 27 months, all these things are published in Telugu Sanatana. Because there is heavy demand from English knowing people, I have to do this. Why I am telling now is to establish its credibility, to make you convinced of this authenticity. I am telling you that. Bhagavan said these things. Oh doctor, you want to know Gayatri? Then he said, where is Gayatri? Where is Gayatri? If that question is put to you or me, we'll say Gayatri is inside. Where? In Prashantralaya. Where? In front of the post office. Where? In front of the round buildings. Oh, I see. So that's the place where Gayatri is present. And Baba said, no. Gayatri is everywhere. In you, with you, above you, below you, around you. Meaning everywhere. Let us be convinced of this statement. That God is omnipresent. God is omniscient. That God is omnipotent. God is everywhere. To say Gayatri is inside in front of the post office. Ridiculous. Gayatri is in you, with you, above you. Everywhere. That's what Bhagavan said. And then started explaining Gayatri mantra. There are three important parts in Gayatri. One deals with the health of the body. One relates to the life, the span of life, the longevity. The third relates to the spirit or atma. These are the three aspects dealt in Gayatri mantra. Am I clear, please? The first aspect relating to the body is Gayatri. Gayatri. G-A-Y-A-T-H-R-I. Second, that which relates to our life span, life principle, is Savitri. S-A-V-I-T-H-R-I. The third, spirit, the consciousness, the Atma, the soul, is Saraswati. S-A-R-A-S-W-A-T-H-I. Saraswati. So Gayatri means three. Gayatri, Savitri, Saraswati. Body, life and Atma. The spirit and consciousness. Am I clear? Because I have been a teacher for the last 40 years. So I think I don't need to doubt my efficiency as a teacher. Since you say you follow well, I am happy about it. So that's then. Gayatri Mantra has another aspect, another plane, another dimension. What is it? Om Bhur Bhuvah Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahe Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat. Come on, repeat. Om Bhur Bhuvah Suvah Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Dhimahe Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat. Om Bho Bhuvasuvah Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat. Om Bhur Bhuvasuvah Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat. This is Gayatri Mantra. I am glad that you repeat it in perfect precision. Perfect. Better than Indians themselves. Is that okay? Yes, I am so happy. This I take it as a miracle of Sai. I am not here to praise you or flatter you. The fact is, because of Baba's grace, you people are able to repeat Gayatri in perfect way. It should be chanted. Good. Swami said three fundamental aspects here. Having mentioned Gayatri, Savitri, Saraswati, now he mentioned another thing. Bhur, Bhuvaha, Suvaha, Bhur, B-H-O-O-R, Bhuvaha, B-H-U-V-A-H, Suvaha, S-U-V-A-H, Bhur, Bhuvaha, Suvaha. These are three important things mentioned in Gayatri Mantra. What are they? Bhur, the body. Inert. This is what is called materialization. Materialization. Gayatri. Bhuvaha. Om Bhur, Bhuvaha. B-H-U-V-H. Bhuvaha, meaning the life. Savitri, vibration. The third, Suvaha, the soul, the spirit, Atma, Saraswati, radiation. Radiation. So, Bhu, body, materialization, Gayatri. Bhuvaha, life, Savitri, vibration. Suvaha, that is Saraswati, Atma, or radiation. So materialization vibration, radiation. Gayatri, Savitri, Saraswati. The body, the life and Atma.
That's what it is, Bhagavan mentioned. And suddenly said, cloth is made up of threads. When once threads are removed, there is no cotton. Similarly, when you do not think of the past, there is no past at all.
When you don't think of the future, there is nothing like the future. Past and future are the products of your thought, like the threads. When once the threads of the past and future are removed, the cloth, the mind, totally vanishes. It totally disappears. And here Bhagavan says, live in the present. Think of the present. Present is divine. Present is life. Because past is death. And the future is uncertain. And in the present, think of duty as God. Work as worship. That is the message of the present. Future is only hope. No message. Where is the hope that one would live? Past has no message because it is gone. The present has got a message. What is the message? Duty is God. Work is worship. And then Bhagavan said, know, understand clearly that your body, mind, senses, they are all negative. And your Atman Parabrahman, the consciousness, the soul, is positive. Everything is negative in this world. And further he said, I, Brahma, Atma, God, Spirit, Soul, Consciousness are all synonyms. They all meant the same. Nothing to worry about it. And suddenly he looked at a doctor and said, you visited super specialty hospital of Puttaparthi this morning. You must have seen a patient there to whom you have given an injection costing 75,000 rupees without any expectation, not even thanks. That's what you should know. You doctors should also know the technicians there in our hospital there, they have two postgraduate students from our university. Dieticians are the girls from our Anantapur campus. You should know that. And then he turned towards a lady and said, you know, this lady I met 40 years ago in Bombay. Because we are strong, we are still alive. What a memory it is. Her house is very close to Dharma Kshetra in Bombay. She lost her husband. And after some time, she wanted to get married. I told her, don't get married again. You have a baby. Take care of the child. Am I not right? That lady started crying. And she is a doctor now, doing lot of service in Dharma Kshetra, Bombay. A very eminent doctor. And looked at that lady and said, had you got married once again, you wouldn't have been a doctor like this. You wouldn't have been able to serve so much as you are doing now. You wouldn't have taken care of your baby. And immediately looked at another girl and said, she is your daughter.
And she is also a doctor, I know. You are also a doctor, I know. You were a baby at that time. Everybody were very much surprised. And looked at the girl and said, your mother sacrificed a lot. It is your duty to take care of her. You are the life, that's all for her. So you serve her. It's your duty to make her happy, that she will never shed a tear. It's your duty, that's what Bhagavan has said. And immediately, Bhagavan materialized earrings for that girl, diamond earrings, and a chain for that old lady. And bless everybody. May you all live a long, healthy and peaceful life, and distributed prasadam to everybody, and had a group photo also, with number of group photos with them. With that, the August episode comes to a close. This month, on 29th of November, a very important event in my life had happened, which I very much wanted to share with you. 29th of November was the day of inauguration of a hospital built by Bhagavan at a cost of 1 crore at a place by name Alike, A-L-I-K-E, 1.5 hour journey from Mangalore in the state of Karnataka. Those people came and requested Bhagavan to inaugurate that hospital. The hospital was completed. Doctors are ready. They are already appointed. And Swami said, I am so busy with devotees here, I am sending Anil Kumar to inaugurate that hospital. I went to that auspicious, important occasion to inaugurate that hospital in the name of Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba. The reception, the hospitality, the attention, the courtesy extended to me was as though Baba was physically present, as though they would do to Swami himself. I went by flight to Mangalore, from there by car. Swami himself gave me the flight tickets. Tickets, I got them ready, you go, and they will receive you by car there. Few things I know, time up, but yet let me complete that. My journey from Mangalore to Alike was something like our journey to Kodaikanal. That full of mountain range, full of greenery, beautiful trees, cool atmosphere, cloudy, wonderful, like paradise. Something like on your way to Kodaikanal. Ah! Tall trees, casuarinas, betel nut trees, plantains, coconuts, waterfalls. Ja, 1.5 hours. Wow! How can I take it? I was extremely happy. My friends, I am fully conscious of the truth I am sharing with you. All along, number of villages across, number of villages, literates, illiterates, rich and poor, men and women, young and old, civilized, uncivilized, peasants, farmers, labor, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, whosoever I saw them on the way, believe me or not, joined their hands and said, Sai Ram, Sai Ram. That's all. Later I came to know, they say the same thing to everybody.
They greet each other like that. I have not seen a smoker. I have not seen a drunkard. I have not seen anybody shouting. I have not seen anybody using abusive, objectionable language. All of them are peaceful and blissful. Quite unbelievable. Then I saw that place Alike. 5 educational institutions with 1500 students. 5 education institutions built on mountain tops at different places. The whole area is spread in 200 acres. You have to go by car to reach different places. So vast. And the guest house on another mountain top. Valleys, playgrounds, stadiums. And when I came out of the guest house, stood there on the terrace, I could enjoy sunrise and sunset in the evening. Back behind, mountain with the trees. In front, valleys and education institutions on the mountain tops. In the morning time, the mist and the clouds. Fog over there. Wow! Kailash, the heaven cannot be more beautiful than this. Yes, I mean every letter I say. I mean it 100%. Then some people started serving me. And everything is kept ready, clean, perfect. And I was served my morning coffee. It was not very, very hot. So I had a sip and left it there on the table. Within 10 minutes, another gentleman brought hot, hot coffee. Then I started tasting it. Then I started inquiring, boys, who are these two people? They said, one is the principal of the college. That one is the warden of the hostel. Each had 2 PhD degrees. My friends, everything is subject to verification. Alike is the place where all of them are brahmacharis, sannyasis, unmarried, like monks of a monastery, like Catholic Church. All of them unmarried. They wear a lalchi and some lungi like thing. Tamilians wear that. That's all. Very difficult to know who has a PhD degree, who has master's degree. All of them are like that. Very simple. And then they have taken me to their institutions. So beautiful. All boys, children, Sai Ram sir, Sai Ram sir, Sai Ram sir. All of them know Veda chanting. All of them are in band. All of them do bhajans excellently. Sai vision. Sai image, my imagination. Sai ideal. All of them have taken a form and a shape 100% there in Alike. The moment I returned, Bhagwan said, come on, Anil Kumar, come on. How do you like the place? Swami, it is of educative value. It is spiritual camp, not a picnic. Certainly not a change. Certainly not weekend jolly trip. It is one of enlightenment. It is one of thrilling, exciting in experience. Baba said, that's why I sent you. I have shown him all the photographs. The hospital also built on a mountain top, a small building. with lawns and flowers everywhere. Doctors highly qualified, ready. Well, I could not believe. And there was one devotee who is no more, a brahmachari, a sannyasi, who used to come to this place as a Sevadal member, inspired by Bhagavan's divinity, donated the whole property, 200 acres to Bhagavan Sita Saiba, where these institutions today are located. All the rest of the people are inspired by the exemplary character, and today we see so many education institutions. With this, I take leave of you. May Bhagavan bless you.
Loka samasta sukhino bhavantu, loka samasta sukhino bhavantu, loka samasta sukhino bhavantu. Om shanti shanti shanti.
Jai bolo Bhagwan Sri Sai Baba ji ki.